are listening to the Freeform Rock Podcast with Mark Alden Taylor.
All right. Welcome to the Freeform
Pod,
as in green peas, or
ultimate
peas
spinach.
Put the pod away. We're kind of reforming a little too much here.
Today, man. So we're actually freeforming it. We're not reviewing a fucking album this right now. This is just going to be a freaking podcast I'm just going to put up. I don't give a shit.
I'm not good at doing freeform. Don't you know that?
Oh my God, you could do the lip wrap.
I'm great at doing freeform spittooey clue on you, on whoever, you know.
Well, we're going to give you the history of Lee Gershman.
Shit, nobody, not even me, wants to know that.
Well, it all started with him and his mom and dad got together. And the rest is history.
But then later, daddy said, you really didn't do right. Nurse, where's the instruction manual? Can I get a refund? Damn it, this one's a lemon. Look at how he's sucking his lips together like that.
Well, the hospital should have had a freaking guarantee, like Toyota of Orange out here in California, where they go, well, you won't get a lemon. I wouldn't have got a lemon from Toyota Orange.
That would have been cool. I would have been wiggling my legs and saying, mommy, remember that song? Da, 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 lemon, 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 da, 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 orange, 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 orange.
Yeah, you're going, dad, mom squeezed your lemon and I came out.
In fact, actually, I had joked with my mom and said, maybe you and I could sometime take a picture of the apartment where you were in, where you were with all those guys, and it ended up being, you know, the result was me. And she went, yeah, we'd have to be in the parking lot in a car, because that's where I did it, in a car.
Oh, no wonder that's why you're so weird.
it's believe me, if you admit any of my other biological family members, you would have thought I was normal, and you would have been frightened out of your you-know-what.
Oh, my God. So, we don't have any groups planned today. We're just going to play music and fucking, we're going to be like Bushy in the Mountain, man. We're just going to play whatever the fuck we want, you know? But this isn't even planned. We don't have songs written down. I'm just going to sit here with a pen and say, Lee, what the fuck do you want to play? But before then, I don't know what the fuck I want to play, so I'm going to fucking... Oh. Hey, I think the movers in August stole a crate of vinyl for me. Because I alphabetized my vinyl yesterday. And I'm missing freaking REO Speedwagon, Nine Lives, and YNT Contagious, and Mr. Welcome to the Real World. I know I had those, unless I was drunk when I thought I bought them.
I feel bad for you for no longer having the Mr., but the other two, good riddance.
You don't like REO Speedwagon, Nine Lives?
Ew.
You don't like Back on the Road Again, the only song they play from that album now?
One song too many.
Fuck. I already know a song I'm gonna play, man.
Oh, shit.
I'm gonna play it, drop
Willie
it.
Willie Nelson, Back on the Road Again. I can't wait to be back on the road again. Making music with my friends. I can't wait to be back on the road again. On the road again.
Yeah, man, let's go light up a joint and get Willie. Or we could play with our Willies and think Willie's here. Oh. I heard he doesn't smoke anymore, though, but that's sad. Because of his health, his lung problem. But you know what? Yeah. I'm going to play a live version of REO Speedwagon's Back on the Road Again just to piss you off, Lee.
Oh, God.
I know you'll play some shit that'll piss me off, so I'm going to piss you off first.
There's hundreds of songs I can think of that'll piss you off.
All right, so here's REO Speedwagon live with Bruce Hall on lead vocals, Back on the Road Again by REO Speedwagon.
Hey! shirt was half off.
I know, that was great.
I paid for falling down.
Timing. I'm the second.
Yes.
I'm
the second. So then slipped down the last two. Where's my Robin?
That was our Speedwagon back on the road again. Lee already says it sucks, and we don't fucking care. We're not reviewing it. We're just playing music.
Yeah, well, that was my review, and it was painful to even talk.
Your review is like Roth talking about Sammy Hagar.
even Sammy Pancake is better than that.
Yeah. So, whoa. It was so bad it made him freaking have a...
I spit out the Oreo Speedwagon!
So you only like Oreo Speedwagon up until Nine Lives, and everything else is crap.
No. Up until Riding the Storm Out.
Oh, wow. You don't even like the Oreo album? We keep pushing on, and...
Oh.
You could tune a piano, but you can't tune a fish?
That's like... Do you ever go into the 99-cent store and see cheese that isn't made with real milk, but it's made with just some sort of oil?
It's called cheese food?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you sometimes get that because you like it as much as a real block of cheddar?
No, I'm
gonna... That's how it's like with Oreo Speedwagon. You either have the real cheese or you have the yucky crap.
Well, I always get Sargento or Tillamook. I get the real cheese.
Oh, so it's still, it's actually well made. It's not gourmet, but it's at least you're getting Riding the Storm Out. But you have to. You have to convert to R-E-O-T-W-O.
T-W-O.
That's the album, the second album. That's what it's called, R-E-O-2.
Yeah, we did a review on that.
Really?
Yeah. We just talked about this on Friday. You already forgot?
Don't rely on me to remember anything.
Damn.
But, Oh, wait a minute. We reviewed an REO album. Which one was it again?
REO 2.
Oh, thank you. I always remember stuff. And yeah, that's
one of
their
best songs
reminder.
Of all time. Golden Country, man. Gary Richrock. Roots on that track.
That's not one of my favorites. but I like the last song on side one, like I forget the name, something. Being Kind Can Hurt Someone Sometimes.
Oh, that's a great song, too.
That's my favorite.
That's a great song. And those fuckers kicked out Kevin after that album, too. And they fucking got a shitty singer in. Fuck those guys.
Yeah. Yeah, screw Gary Richrath.
I love Gary.
Kevin Cronin's best.
Kevin Cronin's
best. Even though I don't like Kevin Cronin now. But back in the day, I loved him. But I'm going back and forth here.
Does Cronin crow too much?
Oh... Actually, if I were to see him in a meet and greet, I would tell him how much I love his music. Even though I don't really love it, but I really do love his music. Even though I don't really love it, but I would still tell him how much I loved it because it's good.
Well, just remember, Lee, you could break in into song at any time and tell me what song you want me to play for the fans to hear. You know,
even
I'll play Ultimate Spinach.
That will be a little tiny bit later. Why don't we do a song by Pentangle called Hear My Call? I'll give you the link to it. Pentangle, Pentangle.
That's what I was saying. Pentangle.
Yeah,
what's the song?
Hear My Call.
Hear My Call. So I don't know what the fuck this sounds like, but Lee likes it, so you should like it, or he'll get angry.
Yeah.
Yeah, so here's Pentangle, Hear My Call in the Freeform Rock Podcast. Yeah, baby, we're free today and we're forming it. That was Pentangle, Hear My the Call? Yeah.
Yeah.
I put Hear My Here. I've been drinking some whiskey, so...
Well, if it came out, if they have a song, Hear My Here, I'd be into it. I'd be into it.
I want to talk about Ultimate Spinach, man, because I went listening to...
You don't
want to
talk about the Styx album, Scrubbing Tiles?
Scrubbing
Tiles. One of their most overrated albums.
What, were they scrubbing tiles? Does that mean they're like getting into the pussy and going, I want to scrub that pussy?
That's what the critics said. They said, we cannot deny or confirm anything. Interview over.
Hey, Lee, I never asked you, what kind of movies do you like, man? You never tell me if you watch movies.
Oh.
You always talk about music. You never talk about movies.
Oh, well, I haven't seen a hell of a lot of recent movies that I like, but in the theater, I saw Spinal Tap.
Oh.
That was a good movie, and I saw Pink Floyd's The Wall. In fact, I had my dad watch it with me on my birthday. I said, the birthday present you can give me is to sit there and watch that movie. And he said it was depressing and humorless, but he said, but I'm watching it for you because it's your birthday. And I went, thank you, because that was the only reason why he would watch it. But I thought it was great.
Yeah.
And
man,
I liked 10 with Bo Derek.
Oh, I remember everybody, that movie, Dudley Moore.
Everybody That's
Dudley Moore was amazing, man. Arthur.
It was hilarious.
Oh my god. Bo Derek was hot. She was even hot in her later years when she was in Wayne's World as the evil mom, man. That was fucking awesome.
Yeah. And I also like There's Something About Mary. That's a fantastically hilarious movie.
Yeah, the best line in that movie, because I'm a 49er fan, and Mary was a 49er fan. It's like, I can't date Brett Favre. I'm a 49er fan.
Yeah. Love that shit. Actually almost made me have tears to think about that. But Reckless was a great movie. That was with Aidan Quinn and Daryl Hannah.
Oh, I remember
that. I loved that movie. And I also liked Splash.
I love
with Daryl Hannah.
Yeah, you know what? I'm sorry, Lee, but this kind of reminds me of you, but John Candy throwing change on the ground so he could look up dresses.
I have to tell you something. Yeah. This is kind of a little bit perverted, but I was about 6 or 7, so I guess I'm allowed to be perverted at that age. I there was some teachers that had these big coats and dresses, and I actually would go under their coat and then stand there, and then they'd freak out. Whoa! And then there was like a teacher I hadn't seen her in quite a while, but I just thought, I'll do a reunion. When she was there again, I went under the coat again, and she was all freaked out. But I was nutty.
You were, and you still are.
But at least I don't go under the coats anymore, because I'm too tall.
You just need to get that hair under control and get a stylist and learn... And dress nice for the women you like to see dress nice. You should dress nice for them also.
Yeah, that's the truth. I'm like Shrek. I'm like a woolly mammoth. All you have to do is hose him down, but then give him a nice tuxedo and a bubble bath, and he'll be good.
Did you like Fiona before she became an ogre, or after she became an ogre?
I have no idea.
She became an ogre. She got big and fat with bigger boobs, though. So I was like, yeah, baby.
Fiona who?
Shrek's wife. She was a princess, and then she turned into an ogre.
I never really saw the movie. I just saw him.
Oh, yeah. Fiona, the girl from Something About Mary, you know, she did the voice of Fiona.
Oh, okay.
Cameron Diaz.
Maybe I saw a little bit of it. Yeah, I would say a lot of people like big women. And so what they do is they tell potential girlfriends, honey, I want you big because you need to store up fat for the winter. So then that way, when we live, when there's an ice storm, you don't have to eat as much because you can burn the fat calories. But in the summertime, I have to feed you with tons of steak and Velveeta and Pillsbury Doughboy stuff and Stouffer's turkey dinners. And honey, if you ever get slim, I'll divorce you. But as long as you stay as big as my bed, I don't need to sleep anywhere else, honey.
Do you know there's medium women that aren't that fat and are really pretty? It's like, this is my rule. I don't mean to sound sexist. If your stomach is bigger than your boobs, you need to lose some weight.
Okay.
If your stomach is bigger than your boobs, there's something wrong. You know, you're eating too much and you need to get healthy for your health. And my wife is freaking gorgeous, man. She has the best looking face. Great, great boobs. Sorry, honey, if you're listening to this, but I love your boobs. You know that.
In truth, I mean, as you know, sometimes when I'm drinking and I'm just mouthing off, I say stuff that just keeps going on. But in truth, there was like a party that I went to. I won't get into details except to say it was like a Halloween party with poetry. But there was this one lady, she was extremely, you know, big, overweight, but she tucked in her shirts. And so I did handshake pictures with her, and I liked her. And then the next year when I went, she was still quite overweight, but she wore tucked in shirts. But I asked her if she would do the pictures again, and she seemed, But it was like, maybe she thought I'm like a pervy, or I don't know what the hell it was, but it was like, you know, she was attractive. And there's other women who are slim, but they don't dress well, and I don't like them. I mean, I'm not saying the shirts are the only thing. There's a lot of things to a person. But if someone is sexy, they're sexy. And for whatever reason, if you like them, you like them.
That's true, man. My wife is sexy as hell, and she wants to get fit, and I'm okay with it, you know. But I tell her, you know what, don't go crazy. And I said, you're still beautiful. I said, but do it for your health, you know?
Yeah, and me, I mean, the one thing that gets me kind of bothered a little bit is when some people say I'm slim, because without my shirt on, when I look in the mirror, I still look like when's the baby coming out. Yeah. I'm slimmer than before, because without getting into too much detail, I had to have surgery for something, which helped, but it's like, so I'm slimmer than I had been. It wasn't fat surgery, it was something else, but it was just, it was something that needed to be done. And, but now, I'm still not at the point where I feel I'm at my best.
You know, I've seen pictures of you a couple of years ago. You've lost a lot of weight, dude. You're looking pretty good. You just got the freaking Einstein hair that you need to comb down sometimes in those videos you show me. I love the songs. I love the lyrics, man. And your voice is unique. You know, it's not bad.
Yeah.
You could at least hold a tone. I can't hold a tone. I'm like,
Well, even though I'm not. Well, I'll put it to you like this. I'm no real, real good singer, but in a few songs like Jumpy Girl, or if I really, really work at it, like a song like Playing Around, I can hold a tune, but it takes me about 20 or so minutes of practice to get it going.
Hey, did you see that thing of Ralph Vieira, our brother, doing Karma Chameleon? Karma Chameleon.
I thought that was cool.
It was pretty good. I was like, fuck. I tried to do freaking the cars moving in stereo. And I was like, life is insane. Moving in stereo. I sounded like shit. Glad nobody recorded that.
That doesn't sound like shit what you just did.
Well, I think it was loud in there, and I couldn't hear myself sing, so I was probably like,
Well, with me, it would be like, no arms can ever hold you like these arms of mine. That's the closest to being in tune that I can be.
Because you're getting in tune, you're right in tune.
Oh, boy.
Hey, man, you know what? Sometimes I do, I feel like I'm the invisible man of the podcast world, you know? Nobody fucking gives a shit about us. But you know what? Then sometimes I go, fuck them. But you know what? I want to play a song by Queen called Invisible Man. That's why I'm fucking getting into this. So I'm going to segue into, here's Queen, the Invisible Man, off their album, The Miracle. I know a lot of people don't like that album, but you know what? Fuck off. I like it. Here's Invisible Man by Queen.
I'm the Invisible Man. I'm the Invisible Man. incredible how you can.
I was Invisible Man by Queen. You know, sometimes do you feel like you're invisible, Lee?
Depends on the visions of your reality.
That was deep, man.
Yeah, in fact, that's a deep song by Ultimate Spinach that you might want to play.
What is it
visions
called?
Visions of your reality.
Ultimate Spinach. Okay, I'm going to play that right now, man. I didn't think you'd come up with a song that quick. Visions of your reality?
Yeah.
Visions of your reality. I just heard the first 5 minutes of that one song I sent tagged you guys in, so it might be better. It kind of sounded like Pink Floyd a little bit, more acid-y. So,
Which song?
The first song I sent you. I don't know what it was. I don't remember.
Oh. What? I thought it was the whole album you sent.
Oh, yeah, I sent the whole album, but the first song is the only one I heard. I need to listen to it. So here's Visions of Your Reality by Ultimate Spinach by Lee Gershman and by Ultimate Spinach on the Freeform Rock Podcast.
I don't want to be a rusty suit of armor. I just wanna be a twisted willow, so I can leave your shallow thinking far behind. Thank you. guess I'd better do things without your help. So I guess I'd better do things without your help. So I guess I'd better do things without your help.
That was some ultimate Spinach, man. We watch Popeye the Sailor Man, yeah. And we go, fuck that. Spinach looks so ultimate, man. We're ultimate Spinach, yeah!
That's actually how the guy almost thought of the name. Remember? What? The reason why I'm pausing when I'm talking is because I have spit, or I have air in my throat, and I have to either burp or swallow. So it's not because I'm hesitating in what I'm saying. Right now, my throat's clear, so that's why I'm talking more smoothly. But when I'm like this, saying that, it's only because of my throat, just to let people know. I don't like my throat and the way that I sometimes can't keep talking. Because otherwise, I can talk like this if I really wanted to. I can talk really fast and it can be really good, and I can do freeform and I can do all that. But if my throat's like that, then I cannot do it as much. You know what I mean?
Yeah, then you sound like Spock. Why? Spock!
Spock! Spick and Spock.
Captain Kirk.
Yeah, that's... I'm Captain Kook, and I use Spick and Spock on my walls.
Spick and Spock, my Spock. somebody needs to suck on my Spock.
Okay.
Okay. Oh, well, that was funny, dude. Yeah, fuck. I want to ask, since we're talking about Star Trek. Okay. Do you like Star Trek?
Almost no.
I was going to ask you, who do you think the best captain is? Freaking Picard or Captain Kirk?
I do like William Shatner a little bit.
Yeah, remember him in the Twilight Zone where he was like looking at the gremlin on the plane? There's something out on the plane!
I've saw only a few episodes of the Twilight Zone. I was more into the Outer Limits.
And I like both Ultraman. Of them are good, though, dude.
Remember Ultraman?
Yeah, but
And the Outer Limits.
Yeah, dude. Irwin Allen was a genius, man.
Yeah.
Rod Serling, man. Outer Limits. Twilight Zone Night Gallery, dude. Come on.
I liked some of Night Gallery, but there was one episode of Twilight Zone where everybody was having to have happy thoughts and never get into bad thoughts because there's a little boy, Billy
Mummy.
And, maybe, but...
I don't like you.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, you saw that.
Yeah, of course I see that. Dude, I love
it. That was a cool episode.
Yeah, dude, and you know they brought that back for Twilight Zone, the movie. The same thing with the gremlin on the plane where John Lithgow says there's something out on the plane. They redid that. And Dan Aykroyd in the beginning, you want to see something scary? And they're listening to Creedence Clearwater. Let the midnight special shine a light on me.
Do you know of the group Barnes and Barnes?
Fish heads. Do you know who they are? Billy Mummy.
You know. Okay, maybe I told you, or maybe you already know.
Dude, we should play Fish Heads now, man.
Sure.
Let's play Fish Heads by Barnes and Barnes, man.
There's a long episode, there's a long video of it with a weird synth in the beginning. If you could find that, that would be good to play.
Maybe I'll find it, man. Because I love that song.
Yep.
Dr. Demento was king when I was a kid, man.
Yeah.
You don't like Dr. Demento? Hey, you don't know Kinko?
His name
Kinko
was Barry Hanson. His name was Barry Hanson.
Uh-huh.
And if you hear the John Fahey album, The Yellow Princess, he's credited as producer. John Fahey, The Yellow Princess. He's credited as producer. His name's Barry Hanson. Barry Hanson. Listen to John Fahey, The Yellow Princess. Listen to John Fahey, The Yellow Princess.
You'll be sending me the links. I'm sure of it.
Okay.
Let's get into some Dr. Demento-ish shit. But not Weird Al. Let's get into Barnes and Barnes and Fish Heads. Roly-poly Fish Heads, but it's just called Fish Heads on the Freeform Rock Podcast.
With Oriental women.
Yeah.
That was Fishhead. Danger, danger, Will Robinson.
All right, since I mentioned John Fahey, why don't we pick, if you can find the song The Yellow Princess by John Fahey, I'm sure that will be my next pick.
Okay. Princess, I got it written down. So I'll find it. I will search high and low for it.
All right.
If not, then there'll be another song.
I will give you links, but
all right.
But I'm sure that it's there.
So here's John Fahey, Yellow Princess, on the Freeform Rock Podcast. Thank you. That was John Fahey, Yellow Princess. I haven't heard it, so I don't know what to say about it.
You'll probably get really pissed at me, but hey, who cares?
Hey, well, we played Fish Heads. What other podcast will play Fish Heads? Fuck!
Hey, man, and Fish Heads and Yellow Princess in a row?
I know. Damn. And we should, you just, know, we should just
that's
go...
That's what I respect about you. I can't always say that I agree with your musical choices. Sometimes I think your choices are like cat food, but you are at least willing to try stuff that's different.
I like listening to new stuff. I like listening to old stuff. I like finding stuff I didn't hear. It's just how
that's
I
roll. That's how I am.
Yeah. But I'm not... Seriously, you know, you like a lot of hippy-dippy... You like a lot of hippy-dippy shit, and maybe I should give Fairpoint Convention. Maybe I'll listen to another album by them, because I do like The Battle of Evermore, and I thought she sounded awesome on that song.
I thought that she sounded more like a guy on that album. Don't know why.
For some reason, I thought that was Ann Wilson, because it sounds like Ann Wilson.
I just don't like that song, but she did a solo album, which might be up your alley. There's some songs that are kind of like English blues rock that sounded a little bit Zeppelin-ish, a little bit. And I guess it's because certain vocal tones remind you of the Fifth Dimension. So regardless of what the song sounds like, you still look at the singer. I don't know if that's true, but it might be like if it's a song like Living After Midnight by Judas Priest,
yeah,
but they had a Fifth Dimension vocal, you might not like it only because of the vocal. Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. The vocals are just, it's just so of the time. And it just reminds me, you ever seen that movie with Cheech and, what's his name? Eric something.
Uh-huh.
Eric, fuck, he was in the Pope Gurnett's Village with that dude who has a crappy
look.
Eric Roberts. It was like a hippie movie where they were all hippies in the 60s. They put Cheech on.
Coca-Cola Kid? I don't know, but...
No, let me look it up, man, because the fans are going to want to know, and I'm being stupid. Let's see.
Oh, Eric, you know, Roberts. More than I do.
It was a good movie, though. It was freaking... what's her name from Airplane was in it, too.
Okay, yeah. Woman from Airplane.
Yeah, you know, the main girl in Airplane.
Yeah, oh, The one who... Not,
got it.
Like, the girlfriend of Robert Hay.
Yeah, Robert Hay is here. Let me see. The movie's called Rude Awakening, man.
I never saw it.
Yeah, it's fucking hilarious. It said, in the 60s, two hippies go off into the jungle to evade the FBI. When they come back to New York in the 1980s, their fellow hippie friends have become rich yuppies. Which always fucking happened, right? All the fucking rich fucking flower kids became rich fucking bankers and shit. That's why I don't like fucking hippie music, because they're all... It was Julie Haggerty.
Oh, okay. I kind of remember the name.
Yeah, Julie Haggerty. Remember?
Was she blonde?
No, she's brunette. She's the one blowing up the freaking auto and...
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. I got her mistaken with someone from Eight Is Enough.
Robert Carradine was in it. Buck Henry. You know Buck Henry?
Yeah.
Cindy Williams from Laverne and Shirley.
Oh, yeah, of course.
That was a fucking funny-ass movie. It's like they come back, they're all hippies. In the movie, it shows the government giving Cheech free acid to see if he could read minds.
Huh.
That's kind of true, right? Didn't they do that? Didn't they give people in the 60s free acid because they thought it would help them?
Actually, when I was in the 60s, I was only a little kid. All we did was they smoked some dope a little bit, got some wine and drank, and just listened to music. And we were listening to the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and Jimi Hendrix and 10 Years After and stuff like that.
Yeah, I like 10 Years After. I have one vinyl by them. I can't remember the name of it, though. But
yeah.
I put them under 10, under T.
Their best album, in my opinion, was Undead.
I haven't heard that one.
That one was a live album that they did in a club called Kook's Clique. And supposedly it was so small of a club that they couldn't put the recording gear in it. But the studios, Decca or Durham Studios, was so close to it, they just had the recording machine in Durham Studios, and they put the wire and the microphones out of the window and then put them in the club. So then they recorded it from the studio, but the microphones were hung out of the window. But that's how they did it, and they did albums like that.
That's cool, man. I remember hearing about, like, they had drum rooms where they put the drums way away from everybody just to get that freaking sound. You know?
Yeah.
That's fucking cool. I don't think they do that shit anymore. They just fucking use Pro Tools and just get shit going, man.
There's one album I'm trying to figure out the group, because I still am not sure what group it was, but on their liner notes it said, to do this album, all of the band members played in a different room, so they couldn't hear what anybody else was doing. And I thought, wow, that must be really crazy.
Dang, do you want to play that 10 Years After live song? Is it on YouTube?
Why don't you do, are you cool with drum solos too?
Yeah, I love drum solos. I'm a Neil Peart fan. Come on, man.
All right, then. There's a medley of Summertime and a song called Shantung Cabbage that you can put for 10 Years After.
Okay, you need to send me the link. 10 Years After,
Summertime. Okay.
Summertime, I'll just put Summertime right now.
And then put a slash and put Shantung.
You just send me the link, man.
Just put cabbage.
Why don't you just... I'm saying you introduce this song then, because I don't know the whole name of it. Introduce it, Lee.
It's 10 Years After. It's a medley. It's Summertime and Shantung Cabbage, which is a drum solo on the Freeform Rock Podcast.
Hey, we'd like to feature our young, handsome, tall, dark drummer now, Mr. Rick Lee from Stoke Newington. A number called Summertime. on drums, thank you. Thank you for your appreciation. We'd like to thank you for coming along and joining in the spirit of the fun. You may all consider yourself recording artists of the night.
All right, that was 10 years after, man. That's probably going to be bitching when I listen to it when I put it together. I like that, yeah. Man. You know, I'm going to tell you, when I used to go, I was crazy. I used to go counseling because I tried to throw a freaking water thing at my mom. You know, the Sparklets water hole container with the water bottle, 5 gallon water bottle in it. I tried to pick it up and throw it at my mom.
Oh.
So I went to after school counseling, and I remember we used to have music time. And this guy brought the 10 years after, if I want to change the world or whatever.
Yeah, that's from a later album.
Yeah, I fucking shit on that. I didn't like it. But now I love it. Oh. Hey, I was young and dumb and fooled. You know, I didn't have cum.
No, actually, it's an okay song. Not their best.
I have that on that album. I like that album. That's all.
Yeah.
I can't remember it, but I remember shitting on that, and then years later, I go, I wish I could find that dude and say, dude, that rocked, you know?
Yeah, I remember in school, there was stuff like, there was an album with a really cool record cover, and in school, in fourth grade, the kids would listen to it on the headphones, and I was like, damn, that's cool. I want to hear it. Later, I realized I had the album. It was Bayou Country by Creedence Clearwater Revival.
That's a great album. That's the album. It's the only one I have on vinyl.
Wow.
Yeah, I love that album. It's just weird how John Fogerty could freaking sing like he's from New Orleans and he's from San Francisco.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fuck, I love John Fogerty, man. I'm so happy you're going to get to see Steve Winwood, man. That's a dream of mine to see Steve.
Yeah. I waited about a month because I wanted to save my money, but it's not going to be close, but I don't need to meet him. I just need to see him.
Yeah, and I have two Traffic albums, and I have his solo album. The one that got me into Steve Winwood was Back in the High Life with freaking that, not the freaking song Higher Love. It was the song Freedom Overspill on that album with freaking Joe Walsh playing the slide.
Oh, okay.
Fuck, that's a great song, man. I'm not gonna play it. I'd rather play a Traffic song. Fucking pick a Traffic song, man.
Me pick a Traffic song?
Pick a Traffic song.
How about 40,000 Headmen.
40,000 Headmen. Cool, man. I love Traffic. I have the album John Barrycombe Must Die and another one I can't remember.
That one's a cool album.
I love Traffic, dude. I love Steve Winwood. I liked him in the Spencer Davis group with Give Me Some Lovin'.
Man, you know about that stuff. Damn. Yeah. I'm surprised.
Dude, he was like 16 when he sang that, and he sounded like he was 30. Fucking
yeah, man. I was 16 when I heard when it came out, and I looked like I was 30.
Yeah, so here's Traffic, 40,000 Headmen.
Headmen.
M-E-N. Yeah, men on the Freeform Rock Podcast.
If I had to take the choice between the deaf man and the blind, I know just where my feet should go, but that's enough for me. I'd turn around and knock them down and walk across the sea. Hadn't traveled very far when suddenly I saw three small ships a-sailing off to towards a distant shore. So lighting up a cigarette, I followed in pursuit and found a secret cave where they obviously stashed the loot. Before the iron gate, quickly rang the bell, hoping I hadn't come too late. But someone came along and told me not to waste my time. And when I asked him who he was, he said, just look behind.
That was Traffic 40,000 Headmen. Oh man, I love Steve Winwood, dude. He's like, he's so awesome. I'm not gonna
remember all of the tunes that I mentioned to you, so you'll have to.
I wrote them down, let man.
No, you'll have to text me or something.
I wrote them down. I want to play a Cheap Trick song, man. But fuck, I'm trying to. I like the '97 Cheap Trick album.
The one like I ain't gonna do da do da no more da 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 da. You ain't gonna da 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 no more da 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 da. You know what I mean?
Are you just saying that they all sound the same?
No, I'm talking about a certain song. Is it the one with the drums and the black and white cover?
Yeah, and the guitar and the like five head guitar.
Yeah.
Let me see, man. I got the track listing right here. I fucking love, fuck, I don't remember. I like it, the song Anytime, the one that starts off, boom, with the freaking drums and shit. Let's play Anytime by Cheap Trick, man, because, you know, Cheap Trick needs more love. You know, they're playing the Pacific Amphitheater here in the summer.
Cool.
And they're headlining, dude. And their tickets are only $30. I need to get fucking tickets for that shit. I've seen them headline once, and they're fucking awesome. I don't like watching them open because they don't do the songs I want to hear when they open. They don't have much time, you know?
Oh.
I want to hear Gonna Raise Hell.
I hear you.
I love that song.
So they did a good live version of that.
Yeah, man, that song's awesome. Now I want to play Gonna Raise Hell, but fuck, I'm going to play Anytime by Cheap Trick. So here's Cheap Trick Anytime on the Freeform Rock Podcast.
Talk to you. I can feel your imagination. a test of your religion. You won't have to bang the bedroom walls. Can you really hold and keep a secret?
Okay, that was Anytime by Cheap Trick off their 1997 classic record that people should go listen to. Man, so...
you probably wouldn't be daring enough to play an Eddie Arnold tune anytime you're sad and lonely. That's the time you're feeling blue. But that was the song my dad used to play. I like that one.
Well, if you want to play it, let's play it. What is it? Eddie Wayne?
Oh my God, that's going to be wild.
Who cares, man? We're just fucking
anytime
around.
Anytime by Eddie Arnold.
Arnold.
E-D-D-Y Arnold.
I know how to spell Arnold and Arnold. And I know how to spell anytime. So, man, here's like two anytime songs. Eddie Arnold. Yeah. So, if you guys hate us, we don't fucking care. So there's Anytime by Eddie Arnold on the Freeform Rock Podcast.
Anytime you're feeling lonely, anytime Anytime you feel downhearted, that will prove your love for me is true. Anytime you're thinking about me, that's the time I'll think of you. Anytime you say you want me back again, that's the time I'll come back home to you.
That was Anytime. I don't know what the fuck it sounded like, but fuck it.
Yeah, the other I can't think of any more right now.
Yeah, fuck, I don't know, man.
But hey, you how about wait if you can play. I'll think of something.
Think of something. But, I already have the next song I want to play.
Oh, good.
But I don't want to play it now. Let's just talk a little bit, and then we can play.
Because that would give me a time to think of more stuff.
Yep. I'm gonna play a freaking just like an 80s freaking classic song that people don't like.
if you do that, I'll try and think of a Utah Phillips song.
I don't even know who the fuck that is.
you won't want to know, but I think he's cool.
So Lee, how do you know all these bands that nobody knows? Did you grow up with these bands, or you just go looking for the obscure?
I do look for stuff that's obscure. I didn't grow up with them, but there are people who do look for obscure stuff, and I find that there's record collectors where if it's an album that came out in the early 70s and you know it wasn't well known at all, but now Japanese record collectors will come and buy them and then do like, you know, they'll sell them for several hundreds of dollars in Japan. And it's trippy how that happens, but there's things like there's a group called Mud. I posted on Facebook and it showed a picture of a bunch of guys in Mud, and it was an album called Mud on Mud, and Randy Castillo was the drummer on it. So, you know, he played in some heavy metal groups, and there's just a lot of stuff that's you know, Peter Chris was in Chelsea, and that's not really worth bragging about, but it was an album that came out in England, and it does cost a lot of money if people want to buy it. And then there's a whole bunch of other... There's so many weird groups that, you know, if you look in record bins, like if you go to a record store and there's a dollar bin where albums are a dollar, and you find albums that are really, really old, but they're only a dollar, but they're not scratched up, they're in good condition, and they're groups you haven't heard of, I'd say a lot of times take a chance, because some of them might have some interesting songs, some of them won't, some will. Same with CDs. If you find CDs, I used to go to the record store, and there were a bunch of different singer-songwriters. I might buy 60 CDs of women singer-songwriters who had, like, promotional copies that were from the radio station for only a dollar, and I never heard of any of them. But you buy three, you get one free, so $60, yeah, I mean 60 CDs, you might end up only paying $45 for 60 CDs. And then I would go and get a lot of the guy singer-songwriters, you know? And I found stuff, a lot of them I don't have anymore, but I had several hundred CDs of these obscure people. And some of the obscure people aren't even from the 60s and 70s. Some of them are from the 90s, but we haven't heard of them. But I think that it's good to further your education musically by listening to stuff that you haven't heard before.
Yeah, man. I like listening to stuff I haven't heard before. I really do.
Yeah.
And you give me a lot of records that I... What the fuck is this? And I still listen to that Boz Scaggs and that...
Yeah.
That Canned Heat are still on my iPhone.
Oh, right? Yeah.
So I still listen to that. I don't really care for Boz Scaggs that much, but it's good stuff.
But you know? But I agree with you. There is one other album he did that I do like, but that one was from Sweden... when he was just a young kid. And it's like, you know, that one, a lot of people can't even get because it's so rare. But, you know, it's cool that you can hear it because it's his acoustic stuff before he went bland, you know?
Yeah, the stuff I heard from him was bland, but the blue shit you gave, we reviewed. And we did review Chelsea, too, so...
Yeah, and I remember that you decided to play Kiss songs instead, which I think was actually a pretty wise move on your part.
Oh, yeah. Peter, you know, people think I hate Peter Criss. I just think there's better drummers than him. I can't stand his voice, but I did like Baby Driver. Baby Driver changed my mind.
That's cool.
But I can't stand Beth. I'll never will like
Beth. Oh, my word. Wow, I totally, totally agree with you on that. That's like, when I first heard Kiss, I got Rock and Roll All Night on a KTEL album. Here's what happened. I first saw Kiss, this is the truth, I'm not kidding. I saw the album Dressed to Kill in a place called The Warehouse. It was like W-H-E-R-E, like where is the house? But it was The Warehouse, and I saw it, and I was about whatever age I was back in 1974, I guess I was 8 going on 9, and I saw that cover, and I actually thought that was how they looked, that they had those weird designs on their face, because they were disfigured. And I was freaked out, and I was like, "What the hell is this?" and I put the album down, and I was like, really disturbed. But then when I saw the K-Tel album, and I saw pictures of rock, they had Rock and Roll Over, the illustration on the cover. Even though they had the song Rock and Roll All Night, and I thought, well, I'm kind of afraid, but I'll put it on anyway, just to see. But I thought, if it's not good or some, I'll be freaked out. But I loved it. And then, for some reason, when I heard the song, I realized then that they were wearing makeup. And then I decided I'm going to look for Kiss. And then, so what I did was, I wanted to get the album with Rock and Roll All Night, but I couldn't find it in the store, because it was just our local record store in town, and they only had Destroyer and they had Alive. And I usually like to get studio stuff before I get live stuff. I do buy live albums, but I usually want to hear a studio album first. So I went and I bought Destroyer, and I hadn't heard Beth or any of that on the radio. I heard it on the album, and I found Great Expectations and Beth to both be pretty horrible. I kind of liked Detroit Rock City. I thought God of Thunder was a little boring, but I liked Sweet Pain. I liked Flaming Youth. I liked Shout It Out Loud. I kind of dug Do You Love Me. So basically, without Beth on side two, if you took that off, you would probably have a completely great album. But later, I got their other albums, and I got Dressed to Kill, which is a great album. I like Paul's songs better than Gene's, but, you know, hey, Rock and Roll All Night, I still love it. But that's the thing. I don't usually like ballads, except if they're... I like certain kinds of music, which means certain chord changes, certain sounds. So if a song sounds good, it sounds good. But let's say someone did a heavy metal version of Who's That Doggy in the Window, it's still gonna be Who's That Doggy in the Window. Do you know that song?
Yeah. How much is
that doggy? Yeah, there? Yeah. Yeah, or Three Little Kittens, They Lost Their Mittens. You know that?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. No matter, even if Judas Priest did that song, it still probably would suck because of the song. So that's why, in some cases, I don't like ballads. But in other cases, I do like ballads. It all depends upon the song for me.
Yeah, I love ballads. I love power ballads. I like fucking Take It on a Run, freaking Poison Every Rose Has Its Thorn. I know you hate those songs, Lee. You don't have to get into it. But I like a good power ballad, man. I love Slaughter, you know, fuck, I can't remember the song, you know. You know, Fly.
You probably would like the 30-minute version of Don't Cry by Guns N' Roses.
No, I like the song Don't Cry, but not that. You know, Fly to the Angels by Slaughter. You know, speaking of Slaughter, that was the next song I was going to play, but not that song. I'm going to play an upbeat song called Up All Night, Sleep All Day by Slaughter. And this is a song I probably thought you would poo on. You probably will. So here's Up All Night, Sleep All Day by a great... You know Mark Slaughter could fucking rip on guitar? Do you know he's a really good guitar player?
I'm not going to be against that. I don't love it, but it's... I guess it's okay.
I need to send you his two solo albums that he's put out the last few years. Fucking awesome shit. He plays all the instruments. Really good record. And he did the Eddie Trunk podcast opening and exit. He's just jamming on a lead guitar, dude. He played all the instruments on it. Fucking awesome. He's so underrated as an artist. All right, so here's Slaughter, Up All Night on the Freeform Rock Podcast. Okay, man, that was Slaughter. Fucking I love that band. I don't care what you fuckers say about it. I don't care if you call me gay. I love Slaughter.
All right. I want to just give you a song just to why the hell not. I don't know whether you like it or not. I don't even know if I've heard it, but I want to put on the Utah Phillips song. And it will be the last song like that that I'll pick. I'll pick all better songs from now on, but it's called Moose Turd Pie.
Moose Turd Pie?
Yeah.
Oh my god. Utah Phillips?
Yeah.
Is it U-T-O-F-F?
No, no, it's like the state of Utah, U-T-A-H.
Oh, Utah Phillips. Okay, I thought you said Utah. Alright,
so... No problem.
Here's Utah Phillips with Moose Turd Pie. Yeah. Sorry, that song is hilarious. Just the title. There's Moose Turd Pie on the Freeform Rock Podcast.
Went down and got a job with the rural electrification in the Navajo Indian Reservation. Running electric power lines into all the Navajo outhouses. One of the first people to wire ahead for a reservation. Finally, I'll tell you about the worst job I ever had in my life. Worst job I ever had in my life was working was it the Santa Fe? Yeah, it was the Santa Fe Railroad south of Las Vegas, Nevada. Yeah, that's the old Mormon Muddy Mission, you see. It's way out in what the Navajos call the boonies. Out in the desert. Now, the job was gandy dancing. Now, gandy dancing used to be in the old days. Gandy dancing was when the Irish were building the railroad. Of course, the first transcontinental railroad was built by Irish laborers. And they used these long-handled shovels called Irish banjos that were made by the Gandy Shovel Company of Chicago. Now, the Irish laborer would take the wide end of the shovel when he could find it, and he would jam it in under a rail or a tie, and he would climb out on the long handle, do a little jig step out there, and that would lever the tie up or the rail up, and you push gravel in underneath it and tamp it down, and that levels the roadbed. See, that's what gandy dancing is, leveling the roadbed so the damn train doesn't fall off as it goes by, which is just a big drag for everybody. Now, they don't do gandy dancing the normal way anymore, see. Like they did in the old days. Nowadays, they run three cars out on the line. They run a box car out there that's a bunk car. You sleep in it. Got bunks in there 18 inches apart. And then you got a tool car with your tamping irons and your tongs and your double jack hammers and spikes and all of that equipment, see, to do the job. And then you got a cook car. I mean, there's no restaurants anyplace around, so you got a cook car. Pots and pans and a coal or wood-burning stove and a long table down the middle to eat at. Only thing they don't hire is a cook. That's because they're cheap. Saves them money. The rule is that in that crew, they're supposed to pick among their own members who's going to be the cook. Now, they don't try to do it sensibly, like draw lots or decide who the best cook is. What they do is they wait and find out who bitches and whines and pisses and moans the most about the cooking. And they say, "All right, wise guy, you think you can do better, you get to be the cook." Well, that was me, see. Old alligator mouth. The new man on the crew. And that was the worst food I'd ever had. I mean, it was dog bottom pie and pheasant sweat. Otter water. Comes out of an otter. It's a terrible, terrible stuff. Some people might think it's a delicacy, but I thought it was garp. So I complained, and they said, "All right, wise guy, you get to be the cook." That made me mad, because I didn't want to cook. But I knew if anybody complained about my cooking, that they were going to have to cook. Armed with that knowledge, I sallied forth over the muddy river. I was walking around among the cheat grass and bunch grass there, and I looked down, and there was just a hell of a big moose turd. Biggest damn moose turd. That was a real steamer. I looked down at that meadow wafer, and I said to myself, "Self, I'm going to bake up a big moose turd pie. Because if anybody complains about my cooking, they're going to have to cook." So I tipped that pasture pastry up on edge. I got my shit together, so to speak. And I started rolling it down toward the old cook car. Bloom, bloom. I got it down there and leaned it up against the side, and I climbed up in the cook car and I baked up a hell of a big pie shell. And I baked that moose turd in it as slick as you please. And I crimped the edges with my thumbs and laid strips of dough across it and garnished it with a sprig of parsley, a little paprika. It was beautiful. Poetry on a plate. And I served it for dessert, waiting for the first hint of a complaint. Well, this giant dude come in, about 5'40", I mean, he was big, throwed himself down like a fool on the stool, picked up his fork, took a big bite of that moose turd pie. Well, he threw down his fork, and he let out a beller, and he yelled, "My God, that's moose turd pie!" It's good, though.
That was Moose Turd Pie by Utah Phillips. Is he a Mormon?
No. He usually does a lot of talking in his shows, and some people are like, I like his songs, but I don't like when he does a lot of talking. I love his talking. He can talk for an hour, and I like him. But that's me.
I like Bruce Springsteen when he talks a lot.
Yeah. So I don't even know whether or not this is going to be an actual song or him talking. But either way, it's going to be entertaining. I think it's probably a song. I don't think Moose Turd Pie would be a talk. I think it would be a song. That's just my opinion.
Yeah, man. Fuck. You pick some cool shit, though, you know, Lee? You do pick some good stuff.
But I am going to, from now on, pick really, really cool stuff. I like stuff that's a little bit diverse and sometimes not rock, but actual. It's just a way for me to give a full spectrum of what I'm into.
Yeah, it's freaking cool, man. This is going to be a long ass podcast.
Because not that I'm not going to pick an Al Jolson song. I'm only going to say Al Jolson, he used to do songs like Toot Toot Tootsie and Mammy. And I used to clap my hands in school and sing like Mammy, oh I love you, oh I love you, Swanee, how I love you, how I love you, my dear old Swanee. I got the world to see, da da da, and Mammy, my Mammy. The sun shines west, the sun shines east. I know what I like the best with my Mammy. And it was stuff from the 20s and 30s, but David Lee Roth liked Al Jolson.
I love David Lee Roth. You know, yeah. I heard he's killing it like a boss, man. He's actually like tearing it up before Kiss, and he's blowing Kiss off the stage. That's what I'm hearing, man.
I will not disagree, because Kiss right now, I'm not going to... I would not pay to see them anymore.
I would have went and saw them.
Oh, well,
I would have went and saw them because I've never seen them.
Well, that's a good reason. I saw them back on the Dynasty tour, and Ace and Gene were the two best. Ace was incredible. Gene was more interesting. He wasn't really greatly musical, but he was interesting. He piqued your interest. But Ace, his solo was like fantastic. He was awesome. He and Van Halen with David Lee Roth and Alex Van Halen, they were the three best performers I've seen live.
Yeah, man. I would have liked to have seen them. And you know, when they played the Staples Center a couple weeks ago, they gave a big tribute to Kobe on those little pods they have. They had 8 and 24, and Paul Stanley wore a Kobe jersey. I thought that was pretty cool of them.
That's cool.
Yeah, I would have loved to see them. And plus, I see David Lee Roth on a second tour with Van Halen after, and then I saw him on the Skyscraper tour, which is really
cool. That's cool.
Yeah, and he had a boxing arena in the middle of the arena, and he surfed back to the stage on California Girls, which is really fucking cool. He put on a great show. He is the best front man of all time.
Wow.
And I'm going to promote this show saying we're just bullshitting about Kiss and David Lee Roth and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You know, mm-hmm. Get people to listen to it first. Yeah. We got some Kiss news, yeah. You know, like the Rock and Metal Combat podcast. They say, we got Kiss news, people. You can just
So was Steve I on guitar?
Yeah, Steve I was on guitar, but Billy Sheehan was not on bass.
Oh, but okay, well that's kind of a bummer, but you still got to see Steve Vai.
Oh God, I love Steve Vai. That's
definitely cool.
Yeah, man, I love Steve Vai. Fuck. Have you ever heard the song "The Audience Is Listening"?
I don't know that one. I had his album called Flexible.
Oh, with Yayo Gak?
No,
you're talking about his first album, Flexible, yeah, that's...
With There's Something Dead in Here?
Yeah, I was talking about Alien Love Secrets, I got confused.
Oh, yeah.
Where his kid went, Yayo Gak, and he went, wah, wah, wah.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, let's play some Yayo Gak, man.
That's funny.
Yeah, I'm going to play some Yayo Gak by Steve Vai.
Why not?
On the Freeform Rock Podcast. Why the fuck not? Here's Steve Vai with Yayo Gak.
Yeah!
That was Yayo Gak. That wasn't the next song I was going to play, but fuck it. I'll move the next song to the next song I play. But you got to pick a song before the next song, so...
Let's see. There's a song that the Stone Roses did. It's the second song off their second album. I think their second album was called Second Coming. I'm not sure. But if you give me just a really quick moment, I can tell you the song that I want. Yeah, okay. I've got them here. Yeah, Second Coming. The song would be Driving South.
Driving South. Got it. So here's the Stone Roses with Driving South on the Freeform Rock Podcast.
I stopped for all my hitching at a low.
That was the Stone Roses with Driving South, and I'll listen to it when I put this podcast together. So I've heard of the band, but I've never listened to them really. So check it out.
That's interesting, because their first album, they it was kind of like a big hit, and people thought they were really awesome, and then they just stopped doing stuff. But one rich, like super rich guy said, I want them to do a second album. So he went and contacted them and said, I will pay all your expenses and whatever you want in order for you to do a second album. And so for about maybe 6 months, all they did was stay in the house and watch television and not do much. But the guy just kept giving them money and kept giving them money over and over and over and over. And finally, after about a year, the album got done, and it was actually really, really fucking good. It's like, who else would give that kind of money and patience to a group of people who were only working like one day a month? But it's actually really, really good music. So he got them to do a second album, but then after that, they kind of pooped out and didn't do anymore.
That's cool, man. I'll listen to it when I download the video and put it in the podcast.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck, I wanted to play a song freaking by Velvet Revolver from their second album, Libertard.
Huh! Called, that's interesting.
She Builds Quick Machines.
Okay, I don't know that song, but I like Scott Weiland. I like Velvet Revolver. I respect them.
Yeah, so here's She Builds Quick Machines on the Freeform Rock Podcast, and we need to review an album by them, because I love that band. Fucking Scott had to fuck it up. All right, here we go. She Builds Quick Machines by Velvet Revolver.
Hold fast, little love.
Okay, that was She Builds Quick Machines by Velvet Revolver. You haven't heard it. I've heard it. It's a cool song. And when you do hear it, you talk about it on the next podcast.
Yeah.
So I think we need to kind of wrap this up pretty quick because this is going to be a long-ass podcast. We're playing like a million songs, but I don't want to bore people. Yeah. I don't think we've been boring, no. Do you think we've been boring?
No.
I think this is cool.
We could finish with a song by the Fabulous Thunderbirds called Wrap It Up.
Oh, that's a cool song. Are you sure that's the one you want to go out with?
Actually, no. Why don't I go out? Let's do something a little different. Let's do the Fabulous Thunderbirds. Actually, yeah, why not?
Wrap it up? I'll take it.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what? When I was going to watch Ario Speedwagon on Life as We Know It tour, we went to the... It's not there anymore. It was the Irvine Meadows. And we got there, and back then there was no internet, so you'd have to listen to the radio to know if a show was canceled.
Yeah.
The show was canceled and rescheduled, and the Fabulous Thunderbirds were supposed to open that show. And but when we went to the rescheduled show, they weren't there. So I was kind of disappointed because I really liked... who's the guitar player, Steve Ray Vaughan's brother?
Jimmy Vaughan.
Jimmy Vaughan, yeah. I really liked him, and I liked the singer. I forgot his name.
Yeah, Kim Wilson.
Kim Wilson, really good singer. And they're still making records without Jimmy Vaughan. So I don't think they're that good anymore without Jimmy. But I also like that album that he did with his brother, you know, Family Style. I thought that was pretty cool.
I'll listen to that.
Yeah, so we're going to wrap it up with the Fabulous Thunderbirds. Wrap it up, man. And to lead, we do your album on Friday. And we possibly have two podcasts coming up because we're going to have maybe Todd Howard from the Ace Frehley Band and his mini solo stuff coming to do an interview with us. So that would be cool. Still waiting for confirmation on that. But Todd Howard would be freaking really cool because I love the Ace Frehley albums with him on it. And he played rhythm, keyboards, lead, and lead vocals on that album. So,
yep.
Freaking killer. So until Friday, man, say goodbye, Lee.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Take it sleazy.
Now, baby, bring your loving straight to me now, baby.
You have just listened to the Freeform Rock Podcast. All music played on the Freeform Rock Podcast belongs to its owner. If you like it, go out and buy it. Get your music on Amazon, iTunes, or at your local record store. Support what you love. Support the artists by seeing them live. Purchase their music. The Freeform Rock Podcast is not affiliated with any of the artists or music that we play. Thank you for listening to the Freeform Rock Podcast. We'll see you on the next episode. Until next time, stay free and rock on.